chair the present session. As Simone has already told you, the session has, there is a slight change in the session, so we have a half an hour exposition by Simone, a general overview. Then Professor Joshi from India will also have a half an hour speech, and there will be comments on that speech by Madame Rupa, from Mrs. Rupa, and Rupa Trilokekar, and Mrs. Sheila Embleton, also on India. So this will be a session, there will be a general overview and then a session on India, and we'll have time for discussions afterwards. Okay, so Simone, would you like to start? And okay. You know, one of my functions is to control the time. And so please don't blame me for that. You know, it's just a function I have to exert at this moment. And I'll be quite rigorous on that. Okay.
Okay, thank you very much. So let's start. Okay, so what I will do is to make a general presentation focused on the issues of expansion and policies related to that. And one of the subtitles of our book is the social pact between higher education and society. I think this is something which was very much behind this whole work, is the idea that there was an old, a traditional way of relationship between higher education, universities, and society, which was that society will give support to higher education institutions and without asking many things. And the higher education institution will provide society with well-trained people, commons, culture, science, research, etc. And this thing is changing very much with the expansion. And so this, the whole issue now is how you renew this pact, how you reestablish this kind of link in which higher institutions are able to do the work and society provide them with support and recognizes the value of that work. So that's the point, that's the title of the book, which unfortunately we don't have enough copies here. We just have two show, but you can get them, or you have a leaflet offering a kind of rebate for that if you want to get it. And this was done together by Romulo Pinheiro, Pandi Pillai, who is here. Romulo Pinheiro, unfortunately, was not able to come, and myself, so we are responsible for bringing all the group together. Published by Springer, that's the book. What these countries have in common? I mean, we choose the BRICS countries not for a special reason, because because there is now a movement in which they link together, they have an organization. We didn't deal with that. I mean, we just thought, well, these were important countries, these were large countries, they have something in common, at least in terms of being important in their regions, in their size. So they are middle-income countries, they are in all of them, higher education is going through a very rapid process of change and transformation. And this is what we wanted to discuss. What is the impact of that? When you talk about higher education research, you have different approaches. There is a kind of more traditional, more usual approach. Very often you see it in agencies dealing with science education policy, in which you talk about the countries, if they produce well-qualified people which are needed for economic development, for competitiveness, et cetera, et cetera. This is a very important approach. Of course, this is one of the functions of higher education. But then our approach was slightly different. We wanted to look at the social process of social mobility and social change. So when this higher education moves and changes, it's not just because the governments decide that it's important for economic development. There is a whole process in which many, many people move, aspire to have higher education. You have values of different types affecting the higher education sector. So we wanted to look at that in this broader sense. And of course, you have more demands, you have pressures for resources, and your governments have to deal with that. And they have to develop policies, not only to meet some targets in terms of manpower, but to deal with a very complex process. And then the idea, which I mentioned, of what's happening with this kind of links of the social pact, which may exist or may have difficulties existing between the two sectors, society as a whole and higher education sector. We talk about higher education, not universities, because universities are just today a fraction, a part of the higher education sector, but higher education is much broader than the universities. It includes vocational, technical institutes, all kinds of other institutions which are not just the traditional universities. So the broad themes is how the in our case the BRICS, but other countries, similar countries in similar situation, are facing being affected by this extraordinary expansion. The other, so you have some positive effects. Of course, more people are getting more educated, or have more competence, more knowledge. But also you have a problem of growing costs. You have what we call academic drift. Everybody tries to be universities, but of course not. You cannot just reproduce the old university model to this kind of very large number of people trying to get into higher education. How the institutions themselves are changing and adapting to this, how they are dealing with this kind of growth. And of course you have the whole differentiation between elite and mass higher education, this whole discussion in the field of higher education. The old institutions in higher education were typically elite institutions. They will respond to, they will enroll 2-3% of, or 5% of the population. Now we're talking about enrollments of 20-30 or after almost 50% of the youth getting into higher education, depending on the country. So there is a, and the other thing which is happening is that the private sector of higher education is expanding very much. It becomes a large business activity also. So there are big companies, there are lots of money involved. This is a new feature which is common to all countries. And then, of course, new technologies which are also coming up and eventually changing the way higher education is provided. Then you have the question of stakeholders. Who are interested? Who is interested in what's happening with higher education? You have, of course, students, you have teachers, you have the professional, the academic profession, but you also have the private sector doing business with that. You have the business sector looking for manpower which comes out of the higher education sector. And of course, you have governments who have to use money and have budgets which have to be provided to pay or not to pay or to deal with this kind of expanding sectors. I mentioned here some of the stakeholders, the new academic profession, students as consumers, students have demands, they have aspirations. You have to deal with investors, you have to have the business sector. So all this makes a very complicated picture in which affects the higher education sector. The broad themes, how the governments are dealing with these issues, and in doing that, how they combine the issues of quality and the issues of social relevance. And the whole issue of affirmative action is part of that. So you have different groups with different opportunities, different conditions to reach the higher education sector to get the benefits of higher education. At the same time, you have a question of quality. You want to do research. You want to train highly skilled professionals. So you want to be selective in how you deal with this kind of dilemma. So the questions then of student loans, how you finance, how you charge fees, how you make the institutions accountable for what they do with the resources they get, and whether the graduates have to pay back society with some kind of services. So all these are issues which different countries are facing. Then, of course, how the institutions themselves are getting organized internally to respond to this kind of situation. One possibility is that they resist, they don't want to respond to the demands they create. So there is a problem, and sometimes they get isolated from society because they are unable to respond to this kind of external demands and pressures. In other cases, they adapt, they transform, they change the way they manage inside themselves. They changed the curriculum. I mentioned just a reference to the Bologna process, which is not so important in our countries, but internationally is very important, in which you change the way the higher education system is organized internally, the careers are organized, how you link with the local interests, with regional interests, with business, et cetera, et cetera. So these are the very broad themes. If I get to try just to give a glimpse of these five countries we're dealing with, these are the countries. They are very large. Of course, China and India much larger than the others, but they are the largest in their region. South Africa, the largest in Africa. Brazil, the largest in Latin America. And they have, India is much poorer in terms of per capita income, but they are middle income countries in general. So this is kind of the general picture of what they are. And what they have in common is this very large transformation of higher education. This is Brazil in 1960 to 2011, the number of students going up exponentially, if you could see the green and red lines, the private sector becoming much larger than the public sector. The public sector doesn't respond to the same speed. And today, 70% of the education in higher education in Brazil is private. This is Russia. Russia had already, the Soviet Union had already a large system of higher education before the changes in more recent years, but it had to go through a very complicated, important transformation, making it link it less directly with the productive system as it was in the past, creating new kind of institutions, creating a market also for the private sector, we'll see more in detail, but it's a very important transformation, although the expansion was not as dramatic as in the other countries, because Russia was already had already a large higher education sector in the Soviet period. India is in very impressive case of enrollments, now more than 20 million, starting almost from nothing in the 40s. So it's enormous expansion, a very complicated system of higher education with different sectors, national institutions, local institutions. This is China, again, this is very similar to India, enormous expansion, particularly since the 90s, much more recent, and growing at enormous speed. Starting really from very little, because the old system of higher education that existed before the communist regime was really destroyed by the Cultural Revolution and other events, so they started almost from scratch, and now it's enormous expansion. This is South Africa, similarly to Russia. They had already a system of higher education before the end of apartheid, but the apartheid brought more demand and the need to integrate to end with the segregation in higher education. The issues of affirmative action became very central to South Africa. So this is the combination of how you deal with this expansion, how you integrate, how you keep quality at the same time that you deal with equity. So it became a very central issue on South Africa. What did we find? Of course, each country is very different. We don't expect all the countries to deal with these issues the same way. But we found that, of course, differentiation is a very important issue. No country can keep higher education just using one model of university. The traditional university, they remain. You have traditional university on the old style, full-time students, full-time faculty, it's research-oriented, et cetera. But this has become a fraction, one sector of a much larger higher education sector. So all countries have to deal different ways, more explicitly, as well as less, sometimes less explicitly, with issues of differentiation. So you combine Western type university in the European tradition with a very broad set of institutions, schools, and distance education arrangements. Even the notion what is a university varies from country to country. So what it means by university is not as consensual as one would expect. In all countries, another finding, governments have and continue to play a crucial role in shaping the ways in which higher education sector evolves. Governments continue to finance higher education. You don't have no country in which the government said, well, let the private sector take care of it. But you have always a combination of government trying to establish policies, allocate resources to different sectors, to establish a quality assurance mechanisms to define what the institutions can do or not, what are the standards they should perform. And, but of course, this role is limited by different elements. You have the resilience of traditional cultures. Institutions, sometimes they accept or accept less this, the interference of governments. You have the limitations, which sometimes you don't have enough resources to keep on financing the same way I used to do in the past. Another finding is that is the private sector. The private sector is expanding everywhere. Brazil is probably an extreme case, but sometimes you don't have enough data because sometimes the private sector doesn't even enter in the public, in the official statistics of the sector. There is this question whether you recognize or not the degrees, how they deal with that. And it's very, very often common that with the kind of culture you have in the private sector, it's not necessarily the culture you have within the universities. You have the non-profit sector, which is more traditional. In the United States, of course, all the famous Ivy League universities are private, but they are foundations, not for profit. We have a tradition of Catholic and religious universities, which are also community-based universities or institutions. But also you have all the for-profit sector, which is even like a business, like a service, educational service provided by the public. And the culture, the way of understanding the role of teachers, what you do in class, the way you study, has changed completely. And the new technologies enter here playing different roles. So there is a complete different game, change of game, and the whole issues of collegiality and intellectual autonomy, the freedom of research and the freedom of teaching, which is are very central components of the diversity tradition. Sometimes they are in difficulties in this kind of institutions. You have the fact that all the government agencies have to deal with these issues of social equity. So the question of how you deal with different nationalities, different racial, cultural, linguistic groups in different countries. You have support and deal with issues of regional imbalance. This is also a common feature which all countries have to deal in one way or another. Another thing, which is very clear, is that distance education is expanding. Perhaps South Africa is a very important example with a very large system of distance education. This is growing in Brazil also. I think it's growing in other countries. So it's the new technology entering and changing the way education is providing. But the impact of that is not very clear. Sometimes we have numbers of how many people enrolled, but you don't know exactly what are the consequences of this kind of changes. And the ICT, the information and communication technology, in a broader sense, this is an issue we didn't show up very much in our study. But of course, this is very, very much an important issue, which is probably will become more and more important in the future. So all these issues are present, and I hope that during these 2 days here, we will see how they play out in different countries as we discuss them specifically. Another element, of course, is the issue of research and innovation. Of course, the traditional university is based on the assumption that research and teaching are coming to come together, are part of the same thing. Today in the world, it's clear that they are not. Higher education, in large part, is teaching only, and research becomes specialized, becomes very, very expensive. So many countries have policies or identifying a small number of institutions which gets additional support and a special mission to work in research. And while other institutions deal more directly with mass education for a much broader public, this is a complicated issue. Brazil doesn't have a policy of this type, for instance, like other countries like Russia or China or India, they do. And so there is a whole issue and this is part of the whole issue of international competitiveness, whether you are able to build, to have institutions we can play an international role to compete at international level or not, which is we'll be discussing this also. Of course, universities are changing internally. They are very often having to deal more effectively with the resources. The collegial mode of organizations, which is in which the faculty really decides what to do in a collegial way, sometimes is affected by the need to be more efficient, to have resources, to use scarce resources, to make decisions of priorities. the way the university, this has to do with how they change internally is a very important issue. We didn't work very much in this project on the internal changes of higher institutions, higher education institutions. This is something that we might consider doing in a future study, but this obviously is a very important issue on how the institutions change internally to respond to this changing scenario. One thing which, of course, is important, it can may happen that the institutions cannot respond well to this change, this pressure. They can resist, they can have difficulties responding, they might lose prestige, they might lose recognition, they might lose support. So you have some problems of institutions decaying while other institutions get more active and improve. So there is a change here in this whole process, depending on the ability of institutions and governments and society to deal with these transitions properly. Of course, as I mentioned here, internationalization is an important issue. I think internationalization have different aspects. The issue of how you compete internationally, how you develop world-class quality, you have all these rankings, and which are not by chance they started in China. China started with this idea of having international rankings of universities, trying to have some universities to compete internationally. But then, how other countries deal or do not deal with this issue. And this has to do with the way research works. And the way quality assurance deals with these issues also. And then you have the issue which is the issue of the creation of international universities themselves. You have some institutions, you've talked about people in the United States, you'll say Harvard, for instance, or this big American university. We're not national universities, we're global universities. Some of them try to establish branches in different parts of the world. So there is a kind of globalization. You can discuss how much this is really happening, or just a rhetoric, but it's happening. And then you have the private sector, which also have, you have institutions like Laureate, for instance, which is a kind of company which has universities in different countries, in Turkey, Brazil, different countries in Europe, et cetera, et cetera. So you have these institutions which are private companies, multinational companies with branches throughout the world. How countries deal with that, how they regulate or not regulate this kind of process of internationalization. We didn't discuss very much. This issue didn't appear very much in our project. None of our co-authors raised this as a kind of important issue, but of course it's very much in the discussion of what's happening, of the trends of higher education worldwide. You have the issue of international flows of students, which is very, very important. Of course, China and India are the largest providers of international students going to Europe and going to the United States. Brazil has also some of that. South Africa has important problems or questions of international migration. I think Russia has also some. So the whole issue of international flows is a very important question having to do with brain drain, but also the whole discussion of an eventual brain gain as far as you are able to establish network, international networks of students and former students. The whole in India, this is very important. In China also, the links with students abroad, the people returning and creating business and teaching in their countries is a very important issue for the higher education sector, particularly in the case of India and China. So you have problems of brain drain, as I said, but also the new opportunities having to do with this kind of linkages. So the main question, really, the general question we have here is the question of how to reestablish or create this kind of links between higher education institutions and society in this completely changed environment. So in this pact, when it works, the higher education sector provides valued goods and services to society. This has to do with education, knowledge, opportunities for social mobility, and society provides services for that. I think a very good example of that in England was the famous University Grants Committee, in which it was a kind of a gentleman's agreement. Universities do whatever they want, the government just gives them the money, don't ask questions. After some years, the system became larger and larger, it was not sufficient, they abolished the University Grants Grant system. We started to create assessment in indicators, all kinds of measurements to see if they are using the money properly, et cetera, and the whole culture of higher education changed completely. So this is the kind of issue. you can say the higher education institutions, they have some core values which need to be preserved. They have to do with they are the institutions which deal with higher learning. They are the holders of the responsibility of developing culture, research, knowledge. They have to have freedom. They have to have academic freedom. They have to have autonomy. They have to be socially relevant. And if the higher education institutions don't do these kind of things, they lose support from society. And this one, of course, the main fact is that this kind of pact, you cannot, societies don't take it for granted any longer. So now the question is, universities have to show that they are doing that. They have to prove, they have to have indicators, they have to have information that society will see and recognize that they are performing a good job. Not like in the old England, which was you just assume that Oxford and Cambridge are wonderful, you give them money, you don't ask questions. This the world doesn't work this way anymore. And so the higher education sector has to respond in a different way. So as I said here, this pact cannot be taken for granted. The institutions have to adapt. They have to create new forms of internal management. They have to take care about which kind of education they provide for the student. They have to deal differently with different kinds of publics, different kinds of students. From those who are in the evening just getting an additional information and qualifications for the job market to those who are doing research at the front end. So I think these are the general framework. I mean, we have been working on this. We have been trying to see how the different countries are dealing with this. And this is what we hope to present you in the discussion for today and tomorrow. So that's it for the beginning. Thank you.
Education in India, and after that you'll have comments also. I call also to the table Professors Rupa Trilokekar and Sheila Embleton from York University. Yeah. So, half an hour, I may warn you when 5 minutes are left.
Fine. I hope to finish before that. I'll be speaking on two aspects of Indian higher education system, that is growth and access. What India has been through, you know, different phases and what it is today in terms of higher education. I'll start with the structure of Indian higher education system, talking about that how Indian higher education system is still bureaucratic in nature, you know. And then types of institutions that we have in India, and the structure of the education system in terms of the types of universities and colleges that we have in India. Now, if you look, the Indian higher education is highly bureaucratic. We have a central government which is called as federal government. Federal government is managed, then we, under federal government, we have a Ministry of Human Resource Development. Under the Ministry of Human Resource Development, we have a Department of Higher Education. Then under that comes the University in Higher Education. Then we have Technical Education. And this is all when you talk in terms of the federal government. On the other side, when you talk about the provincial or the state government, every state government has a Ministry of Education. Under that, there is a Department of Education. And under that, universities and affiliated colleges are part of that. So probably you can see that even today, Indian higher education system is highly bureaucratic. Now, in India, we have three types of universities. Central universities, these are the universities that comes into practice through the Act of Parliament. We have state universities that comes into picture through the state legislation and deemed university. These comes through the gazette notifications of the federal government. Now, again, when you try to look at the three types of universities, we have central universities, the universities that are run by the federal government or central government, central open universities, deemed universities, institutes of national importance, even they give the degrees, like IITs and IIMs. State, under the state, you have a state public university, state open universities, and the institutes established by the state government. And then you have a private university, private universities, under that you have state private universities that comes through the state legislature, and you have private deemed universities that comes through the gazette notifications. Fine. Then again, we have colleges, we have affiliated colleges, constituted colleges, recognized centers. So again, you can see that the structure of Indian higher education system in terms of the institutions is also too large. Universities are unitary type. They have single campus, they have multiple campuses, you know. Campus within a city, then campus in other cities also. In South Asia, we have a typical system of giving affiliation to the colleges. These colleges do not run the program on their own. The curriculum is given by the university. Examinations are conducted by the university. The colleges simply play the role of teaching shops. Only teaching is carried out in most of these colleges. They do not have right to conduct their own exams. They do not have right to design their own curriculum. Everything is designed by the university and given to the colleges. This is the system that we have. Undergraduate program in for humanities, sciences, and social sciences is of 3 years after 12 years of education, except engineering, which is 4 years, medical, which is 5 years. Bachelor of Education is 1 year, that is given after having one bachelor degree in any discipline. You can see postgraduate program for most of the universities is 2 years, except medicine, you know. And then we have MPhil program, which is a program between the master's degree and PhD degree, fine, Master of Philosophy. And then we have a PhD program, which is roughly 3 years, fine. So this is the setup of the program. Now, Indian higher education system is the largest higher education system in the world in terms of number of institutions. You can see that roughly we have 37,000 institutions in India. That includes 36,671 colleges and 712 universities. That is 8 times more than the total number of institutions in Europe. Fine. Almost 8.5 times the total number of institutions in the United States. Fine. And roughly 7.5 more than China. So probably you can see that in terms of number of institutions, we are the largest system in the world. Fine. You can see the growth that has taken place. The very interesting thing here is that the post-2000-2001 growth is exponential. Fine. Prior to that, we did not witness so much growth in terms of the increase in the number of institutions, both in colleges and universities. It's largely because of the privatization, the global policy we went for. Now you see the type of number of universities. The central universities are 42. State is 310, deemed university is 127, state. Now what is interesting is that state private universities 143, 12 years ago they were only 2 in numbers, but now they are 143 in numbers. So probably you can see that state private universities are increasing at a very faster pace. These are the type of universities and their share that I have shown. You know, you can see the share of the central university, which receives the largest pie of the federal funding, you know, is only 5.90 in terms, and whereas the state private university is 20%. State public university represents the highest number of universities that we have in India, that is almost 44%. Now, where are these universities and colleges located? Now, if you see that most of the universities are located in rural areas, but effectively they are not rural areas, they are on the outskirts of the urban areas. Fine. In terms of the definition, they are in rural areas, but practically they are on the outskirts of these urban areas, you know. Bigger cities like Delhi, Ahmedabad, Mumbai, and all cities outside the city, you know, maybe within 5 to 7 kilometers, most of these universities are set up. There are very few universities which are practically in rural areas. Same is for colleges. See, the same thing has happened in terms of enrollment also. Now we are almost 30 million students are enrolled in Indian higher education system, you know. When you talk in terms of enrollment, India is the second largest system in the world after China. China has the highest enrollment in higher education system. And you could see the participation of female also has been increasing from 1950-51. Female have been almost 43% of the total enrollment in Indian higher education system. But this, despite 30 million, when you try to look at the gross enrollment ratio, still we are very low, you know. It's just 21.1, you know. And when you try to look at male-female, then you find a disparity that the male GER is 22.3 and the female is 19.8. Fine. But even if you try to look 21.1, you know, with 30 million, you know, it's this shows a very small number. If you look at the enrollment at the undergraduate level, you know, you can see that majority of the students are enrolled in arts, humanities, and social sciences program, which is almost 41%. Fine. Engineering is 16%. I'll show you the change that has come during 5 to 7 years. And this is the current as of 2014, you know. And you can see that in IT, commerce, engineering and technology, arts, humanities, and social sciences, these are the disciplines that dominate. When you try to look at the enrollment at postgraduate and PhD level, the scene changes, you know. There is high enrollment in science, which reaches almost 20%. In social sciences, it comes to 20%. Fine. Indian languages, it is roughly 7%. So you can see that enrollment in arts, humanities, and social sciences and languages at undergraduate level is 40%. But when you try to look at postgraduate level, their enrollment is lower. Fine. Now, this is the discipline-wise enrollments. Overall, this is for 2005-06, fine. And you can see what is the change in engineering and technology. It was just 7.21%. In arts, it was 45%. And now when you try to look at 2013-14, in arts and social sciences, it has gone to 36%. So there is a decline in enrollment of students in arts, social sciences, and languages, whereas there is an increase in enrollment in engineering, which was 7, that has gone to almost 16%. Similarly, in science, there is a decline from 20% to it has gone to 17%. But in commerce and management, again, there is a rise in enrollment, which the share is almost 17%. Fine. Now, where does the private sector stand in this enrollment sector, you know, or in enrollment scenario? You can see that in 2001, you know, the percentage share of private sector in terms of enrollment was 33%. And in 2012, that has reached to 59%. So after 2000, post-2000, the share of private sector is increasing at a very faster pace. As in India, we divide the private sector into two parts, private aided and private unaided. Private aided is the one where government funds the recurring expenditure of the institutions. And there is another that is called as private unaided, where they do not get any sort of funding from the government. You see the total number of, if you try to look at the institutions, you see that the private unaided are more in number, but the enrollment is lower. Private aided is 14.9, but when you look in terms of the enrollment, it is 22.7. The government is 26.9% institutions, and the enrollment is 37.7. Now, why there is huge enrollment in both private aided and government? Because the student gets subsidies when they go for studies in these two institutions. But the private unaided institutions do not get any funding either for research or for any of the teaching program from the government. Now, what is worrisome for the government, you know, and for people is that most of the professional programs have gone into the hands of private sector. You can see engineering, almost 91% of the programs are run by engineering, private engineering colleges. 95% of the pharmacy colleges are in private sector. Similarly, 67% are in architecture, you know. In medicine also, almost 50% is with government and 50% is with the private sector, you know. So except medicine, you can see that in almost all the disciplines, you know, professional programs, the private institutions are dominating. The number of teachers have also increased, you know, it's almost, it has gone to 1 lakh, 10 lakhs, you know. Student-teacher ratio is not good in India when you compare to the other countries, you know. India, it's 24. For Brazil, it's 22.2, you know. So even that needs to be addressed despite having a huge number of teachers, you know, we have not been able to address this issue also. If you try to look at the teaching staff by designation, you know, almost 7% of the teaching staff are professors, 70% are assistant professors or lecturers. Now we do not have the designation of lecturers in India. We have assistant professors only. That has been removed by University Grants Commission. Now this is the funding by the state and the center, provincial or the center. You can see that most of the funding in the higher education is carried out by the state government or the provincial government, you know. Their share is more than 61%. On the contrary, if you try to look the number of institutions with the state government, they are much higher, you know. There are almost 96% of the institutions are with the provincial government, you know. Less than 4% with the federal government. Despite that, if you try to look at the figure, the funding by the state government dominates, but it is much low when compared in terms of the number of institutions that state governments do have. Now, what are the factors that have influenced the demand for higher education in India? The first is the gross enrollment ratio at higher secondary has increased over the period of time. I have given a data from 2004-05 to 2013. Now, you can see that it has reached almost 49.1%, you know, in 2013-14. Unfortunately, the transition rate between higher secondary and higher education has not improved drastically as the GER at higher secondary has improved over the period of time, you know. Average age in 2020 in India, you know, it will be roughly 29, you know. And you can see that India will have almost 116 million workers, and this is also creating a demand for higher education. Higher education enrollment is also expected to reach almost 42.1 million by 2020. 2012 has been achieved, you know, so we are expecting that roughly 43 million would be achieved by 2020. If you try to look at the labor requirement has also changed, you know, if you talk in terms of millions, you know, for the world, probably you can see that even this is creating a demand for higher education in India. This figure gives the shortfall or surplus of labor by 2020 in millions, probably. You can see that India is the one, you know, that is producing or that would have the highest number of surplus labor in 2020. You know, countries like even China is likely to have a shortfall. Russia is likely to have a shortfall. Others are also likely to, overall minus 12.5 would be the shortfall for most of the countries, you know. Urbanization is taking at a very faster pace in India, probably from the 2011 census reflects this, and this urbanization has also led to increase in the demand for higher education in India. The second part that I'm talking about is that what has been the access and equity in terms of the higher education in India. Now, India is highly stratified in terms of the social groups that we have, you know. We also have scheduled tribes and scheduled caste, the aboriginals, which is the word that is used in many of the countries. And we have also socially and economically backward group within the Indian population to which we have given reservations. When you try to look at the male-female representation in terms of equity, you know, you can see the female representation in almost all the faculty is low except education where females dominate, you know. In medicine, it's 50-50%, but in rest all the faculty, you can see that females' representation is lower than males in Indian higher education system. The gender parity index, you know, which is we calculate is GER of females by GER of males. If you try to look at the gender parity index, there also it has improved, but it's not good, you know, because it's still below 0.89. But the good thing is that in some of the provinces like Kerala and Himachal Pradesh in India, you know, the gender parity index is almost 1.31, which is comparable to developed countries, you know. So there are some provinces within India, you know, where the gender parity index is more than one, you know. There are 5 states in India which have gender parity index more than one. You know. And similarly, there are states very like Chhattisgarh and other where the gender parity index is around 0.5253, which shows a huge disparity among male and female in terms of access to higher education. Fine. So we need a state level or provincial policy to address these issues. If you try to look at the gross enrollment ratio across the different religions in India, you know, you can see that Muslims are the worst affected people in India, you know, and we need special intervention policies for Muslims residing in India, you know, because their GER is just 11%. Fine. The GER for Muslim population is just 11%. When you try to look at Buddhist and Hindu, it's not that good, you know, 18 and 20. But for Jain and Zoroastrian, you know, it is almost 55 and 64%. Christian Sikhs, it's 30%. That's also not good, you know. But when you try to bifurcate this GER by rural-urban classification, you can see that, you know, Muslims are the worst affected people, you know. Rural population of Muslim have gross enrollment ratio of just 6.7%, which is very low. So Indian government needs a specific intervention policies for the Muslims residing in the rural areas of India, you know. You can see just 6.7%. So they have a very low access to higher education. Fine. Similarly, Buddhist living in the rural areas of India, even they have low access to higher education, which is roughly 12%. When you try to look gross enrollment ratio across the different ethnic groups in rural and urban areas, which is SC and ST, you know, scheduled caste are the group, social is a sort of social group which is at the lowest hierarchy. Scheduled tribes are the aboriginals, people who have been living in forest for many years. OBC are other backward caste. Fine, they are also called as SEBC, socially and economically backward caste. Fine, and others. Probably you can see that the position of aboriginals is very bad. The GER is just 7.1%. But if you try to look at these aboriginals who have come to the city areas, you know, left countryside, for them the access to higher education is almost 31%, you know. So probably that is an improvement that we find over the period of time. Now, if you try to look at the expenditure on R&D as percentage of GDP, in India it has been stagnant for the last 3 years. It's been 0.90. China is improving. Japan is almost constant, you know. Germany is improving, but if you look in terms of R&D expenditure in India, it's still very low, you know. Probably even you can look at this from the citation of Indian publications, you know, and the impact factor that we have. Now, this is a big question that comes before me, you know, and when you try to look at the unemployment rate in India, you know, for people in the age group 18 to 29 with a graduation degree and above, it's 28%. Fine. But when you try to look at persons with this degree, graduate and above, you know, and 30 years and above, then it's only 3%. The overall unemployment rate in India is 3.6%, but you can see that for those having graduate degree and above, you know, for them the unemployment rate is almost 28% in the age group of 18 to 29. Now, probably this is a common feature that we find in China and India, you know. The labor market is not in a capacity to absorb this because almost 1.4 million engineers India produces every year. Of that, you know, only roughly 63% of the engineers are absorbed by the labor market. Probably if you look at the data for the China also, because see, 30 million people you are graduating or you are giving access to higher education almost every year, you know, where do you sell them, you know? Which market, which labor market would absorb, you know? Fine. So probably this is one big issue that India is facing at the moment. The problems with the Indian higher education is we have been expanding, but in terms of quality, we have not been able to come in the rank because in global ranking still we are low. We have a program accreditation and assessment of higher education system which is largely institutional accreditation rather than an individual program accreditation system, and which has been ineffective in terms of, you know, whatever grade an institution gets, there is no specific funding that comes from the government if an institution gets good grade or if an institution gets bad grade. So in fact we have not been able to link the funding mechanism with the accreditation status of an institution. We have a disparity in quality and funding of institutions when you try to look at state, province versus the central or federal. Almost 3 to 4% of the federal institutions receive more than 80% of the total funding of the federal government. So there is a disparity in terms of funding for both state and federal universities. There is access has increased over the period of time, but disparity has also increased simultaneously between the deprived group and the group which are better off, you know. There is low efficiency of higher education, as we see from the employment rate data that comes out every year, you know, for the graduates and above. And unfortunately, higher education system has failed to address the labor market needs, especially in the professional programs. As I said, you know, producing almost 1.5 million engineers every year, and of them, only 60-65% of them get absorbed. So even for the engineers, almost 30-35% of the engineers that we produce every year remain unemployed or work in an area in which they do not possess degree. Fine. So this is the scene, you know, and with just 21.1% GER, imagine, you know, if we go to around 40% GER, where we are going to sell our students, you know, where they will be absorbed, you know. So probably what is required is the skills that must be imbibed in these students, you know, for the future, so that at least in the international markets, they can go and they can do well, you know. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
As well as, I think, some of the comments he made about Indian higher education in terms of access. Just bring out a few points that perhaps we can will lead to discussion after our session. I also have to say that I am from the Canadian system. I work in the Canadian higher education system, and my focus is really internationalization of Canadian higher education, but I do look at India. So I'm just always conscious of the fact that I'm an outsider looking into a system that I don't belong to. So a lot of my comments are phrased from that perspective. Not here? Can you hear me now? So in terms of Joshi's chapter, I think he speaks very much about issues of access. And I think in terms of the charts, a lot of his charts do suggest that there has been a lot of improvement over time in India in terms of access. When you look at the GER, which is the gross enrollment ratio, it's currently at approximately 20 to 21%. And this is big if you look at India historically, because since 1999, especially if you look at the reports, it seems like the GER has doubled, which is large when you're looking at such large numbers. In the four decades, it's been like a 12 times increase. So there's been a substantial growth, as well as you saw from his charts, access to marginalized populations has changed in India. When you look at what we label in India scheduled tribes or scheduled castes, or the poor lower SES, the socioeconomic class, or even women, gender being an issue. But I think his comments as well as his charts also suggest that there are many very big challenges still facing issues of equity within the Indian higher education system. And I just want to raise a couple of issues in relation to those issues of equity and access. I'm always perplexed, I don't know, because scholars look at it differently, whether India has really moved from an elite to a mass higher education system, and whether we can really say that we have achieved mass higher education. And this is the reason I raised the question. Because especially compared to China, for example, I think, which has reached much more of a massification, almost universalization of higher education, if you look at the Chinese figures, I think they've ballooned from 6.3 million in 1998 to 19 million in 2003, if you look at those statistics. Also, in terms of something that Professor Joshi has already mentioned, the gross enrollment ratio is so ununiform in India that one questions this whole idea of massification. Because if you look at territories like Daman and Diu, the gross enrollment ratio is only something like 2.3%. But if you look at places like the Delhi capital, it moves to 47.9%. So there's massive regional variation that questions the success that the Indian government has had with access. There's several issues of imbalances with caste, gender, socioeconomic, religion, subject areas, as was shown. And these variables are extremely compounding in terms of limiting access to marginalized population. So despite the growth, again, obviously, the issues of social inequity remain. in spite of the improvement made in access overall. There's also one more factor that he mentioned that I'd like to raise is about unemployment, but underemployment as well of these graduates. And I think there's lots of research showing that a lot of the employers, there's research showing that the employers, for example, there's a survey done where they said that 64% of employers say that really they're not very satisfied with the skills that graduates are coming out with. And these are engineering graduates. So exactly as he said, there's a mismatch between the labor market needs as well as what education institutions are producing, not only in terms of quantity, but in terms of quality. What are the skill sets that are being provided to these graduates who are finishing higher education? So again, the issue of access is much more than just providing entry, but in terms of quality. And this is where I'd like to focus my comments this morning, is I think access continues to be a challenge for the Indian higher education system, but it is interesting that in its 12th five-year plan, because India has a five-year planning cycle, that's the five-year plan for 2012 to 2017, that India sees three interlocking issues as the key issues that they'd like to build their policy framework on. One is expansion. They call it the three E's. One is expansion, the other is equity, but the third, which I would like to highlight, is excellence, because the government is more and more looking at the issue of access, not only linked with equity, but more importantly, it's concerned with access to quality, quality institution, quality education. So in the few minutes allocated, I'd like to focus a little bit of my comments on how the Indian government is recognizing this idea of excellence and the importance of excellence in relation to access, but what sort of challenges remain in considering quality education in India. And this is where I think Professor Schwartzman has raised in terms of globalization and the global context stands to provide the framework for this conversation on excellence in India. Because if you look at the 12th year report and several of the government reports from India, one of the things that's very clear is that the Indian government is very cognizant of the fact that Indian universities are not among the rankings, especially among the top 200 rankings of universities. And China does have a whole lot more. And they're very, very conscious. You will see this repeatedly in several of their documents, that there are only two that show up in the top 500. And so this issue of university rankings and global rankings seems to sort of situate this idea that they need to build specific world-class institutions in India. And there's some very interesting comments made consistently by the leaders of India. For example, I think in one of the reports, the former Prime Minister Manmohan Singh is said to have said in 2007 that almost two-thirds of our universities in India and 90% of our colleges are rated below average on quality parameters. And 13 years later, you're seeing the same comments showing up when the President of India in 2013, Shri Pranab Mukherjee, said something to the effect that there is need for Indian universities sort of to catch up with their counterparts when it comes to quality of teaching and research, and that we have to have more research universities being established in India. So I think there's a real recognition that quality is important, and you have to have quality in terms of improving access as well, along with expansion and equity. But how does one go about providing quality higher education to a system that's so extremely large and has real fundamental issues with financing or funding? One of the things that at least we found interesting when we were looking at Indian higher education government policy documents is that for the first time, the Indian government actually brings the issue of internationalization of higher education as a priority in its 12th five-year plan. So it suggests that internationalization of higher education is the one way that India can actually improve its quality, and it sees it as a mechanism to improve its quality and provide better access to its local population. Prior to that, we haven't seen the term internationalization used as a strategy by the Indian government. The Indian government looks at internationalization, in their words, as a win-win situation, because for one, it sees the entry of foreign educational institutions as necessary to provide and to improve the access available for Indian students. it sees it as a way, and this is their language that I'm just repeating, it sees it as a way to bring global practices to higher education in India. It sees it as a way to save millions of dollars right now that go out with Indian students studying abroad. It sees it as a way to check brain drain so that they don't lose as many qualified Indians abroad. It also sees it as a way to bring some Indian institutions into the global rankings by bringing in improved research performances into their institutions. And as Professor Joshi's slides have shown, expenditure on research and development is extremely poor compared to many countries, and India is again very cognizant of the fact that in terms of research publications, I think China in 2011, when they calculated, had 5 times more of the publications than any Indian academics do, than most Indian academics do, in spite of the fact that language is not a barrier in India as it is in China. So there's this constant question of, you know, how do we get internationalization to help improve the quality of Indian higher education? There are several new initiatives that the Indian government has come up with. For example, there's a University of Research and Innovation Bill to build up world-class universities in India. There are mechanisms in India to help enroll and recruit foreign faculty, which is very new in the Indian context, to bring in Indians who have settled abroad to come back to teach in Indian institutions. Very recently, the Prime Minister, the current Prime Minister, started a new initiative called GYAN, which is the Global Initiative of Academic Networks, where about 1,000 American faculty can come and teach in Indian institutions. They have signed agreements with the UK, with Russia in terms of joint universities, started new joint programs for faculty exchanges. Even salary scales for Indian faculty have gone up quite high compared to what they used to be. In fact, I think some reports suggest that it's among the higher faculty scales compared to most other countries in the BRIC, as again mechanisms to make India more attractive internationally, to bring in more institutions. So these are some examples of what's happening with internationalization as a strategy to improve the quality of Indian higher education. But I think one of the fundamental challenges I see, and I'm sort of perplexed about, is how, in spite of all of this, there's been a stalemate in the Indian system where two bills, one is the entry of foreign educational institutions and the collaborations between Indian institutions and foreign institutions, these are two bills that have been languishing for years now in the Indian Parliament in terms of getting signed off. So basically right now there is no government legislation that allows foreign institutions to set up shop in India. You cannot have a foreign institution provide degree programs in India. There are several, but they aren't approved programs. And similarly, there is this resistance of the Indian government enabling Indian institutions to set up their branch campuses abroad or offer programs and degree programs abroad. It's fascinating because you would think of India as more of an open country, democratic, but ironically China, which is supposedly from the perspective of the outside world a closed country with more of a controlled government, has almost for 30 years allowed foreign institutions to set up institutions in China. I think by 2009, there were something like 1,000 foreign educational programs and institutions available in China in 20 provinces. So I find that perplexing, that India hasn't approved this kind of these bills that have been lying in parliament for many, many years now. There are several roadblocks to actually enabling successful entry and setup of foreign institutions in the Indian higher education sector, although that's identified as per Professor Joshi's comments as well as the fastest growing market in higher education. So it's perplexing to see why in a system in India there is such ambivalence to having foreign providers, even though internationalization is recognized as a strategy by the government. And I would just like to leave you with a thought about where this is perhaps coming from. I think it links back to what Professor Joshi said. The fastest growth in the Indian system has, interestingly, been in the private sector. About 59% of private institutions absorb the growth in the Indian sector. Professional programs, 79% are private institutions. But for some reason, I think there's a real resistance in the Indian government, as well as in terms of the social ethos, to accept privatization of higher education. So it's there. But it's not been recognized formally in the same way, perhaps, as it should. Interestingly, again, compared to China, the growth in China has been mostly in the public institutions, not the private institutions. Expansion has happened in the public system, although it has happened with increased tuition fees. So perhaps in a way you could say China has moved towards privatization of a public system, but in India, fees have remained relatively low, and it's the private system that has expanded. But I think there is this dilemma within the Indian education system about accepting privatization that links very closely with accepting foreign institutions coming and setting shop in India. And to me, to some extent, I think India has to face head on in terms of these issues of globalization and higher education, and has to sort of come up with some kind of a framework, policy framework to handle these issues of internationalization and globalization. But for whatever reason, and perhaps we can look at that, there seems to be resistance in terms of accepting, A, recognizing that privatization is one way to legitimately increase higher education, and B, to sort of pass these bills that would allow for more internationalization and globalization of its higher education system. Again, I find that perplexing, considering that China has sort of pretty much engaged full horn on in terms of internationalization. It has encouraged international institutions to come in. It has had 10 times more than Indian students. It had sent students abroad. It has umpteen a number of international students coming and studying within its own sort of national boundaries. So being a democracy, being sort of an open government, I'm very, very surprised at this resistance of the Indian government. And I just leave it at that in terms of the fact that there is this protectionism within the Indian state or the Indian system that seems perplexing to me in terms of moving forward. So I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Sheila Embleton to make her comments.
Thank you. So I've been asked to talk about India, but actually I'm probably going to talk more about Canada, but from the point of view of raising questions. So first of all, Rupa introduced herself as saying that she was an outsider to the Indian system. Well, all I can say is I'm even more of an outsider to the Indian system. My perspective is that of a now former vice president, academic and provost at York University, who worked on a number of India initiatives, including many with Rupa, on India, and I won't detail what they all are, but one in particular was as our business school, the Schulich School of Business, tried to set up a campus in India, and that is a very long saga and could make for a very long speech, but it has informed a number of the things that I might say about India here. Okay, so for me, when I think about access, I always think about access to what, but I also think about access for what purpose in the end. So put in its simplest forms, access to what is to what programs, what quality of programs, is there something worth going to? Brings up the quality issues as well, but also for what purpose? So it's all very well to go and get a degree, but if it doesn't lead to anything, and the anything seems to be increasingly in terms of employment rather than things like learning, learning skills, learning things that will equip you for the world, education for democracy, all of these kinds of things seem to be slipping by the wayside. And it's all around labor market, always labor market and the needs. It also tends to be very short term about labor market, within 6 months, 2 years, how many of your students have graduated and got a job in the field for which they were educated. Very infrequently do we look 10 years out, even 20 years out, maybe it's partly because it's hard to trace your graduates at that point, but see what it has meant in terms of quality of life, ability to roll with the punches of the labor market. You know, it's all very well to be trained and walk straight into a job, and then that field dries up in some way, disappears, and then what? And we're seeing exactly that at the moment in Canada, where, for example, petroleum engineers, no problem getting a job. You know, in many cases, part of the problem is you could get a job before you finished your university education. We used to see it with computer scientists. And so you maybe didn't graduate, but your university education got you straight into a job. Perfect labor market situation. What happens when the bottom falls very suddenly out of the petroleum industry in Western Canada? You now have a huge number of petroleum engineers who are unemployed, and they're mostly trained to be petroleum engineers. They don't have a whole lot of alternative without retraining again. So when I come back to then think about access, I think, wasn't it great? We got them all into programs, we trained up a whole lot of petroleum engineers that looked great for a while, and then all of a sudden. So coming back to that general question, access, to what and for what purpose? So Canada has a very different situation probably from most of the countries that we're going to be talking about here today. Very high GER, well over 70%, still increasing. And in fact, some people, such as our colleague George Fallis, would say that it's essentially universal higher education at this point. Everybody who wants gets a place. So if you scratch, though, below that surface a little bit, the over 70% is largely because of college as opposed to university, so the more vocational training. And then when you start to look at the demographics, you find that all of those usual things of social class and ethnicity and so on show up. And you can predict probably which ones are on the college side, which ones are on the university side. We have regional differences. So, for example, the province of Ontario, where we come from, would be very high compared to the north, for example, or even, strangely enough, British Columbia. Sometimes that's for kind of good reasons. You can get jobs without, let's say, you can get good jobs even without university degrees, such as formerly in northern Alberta. But also look at, for example, Aboriginal, and if you scratch below the surface, the GER is very, very low. There are issues around class, but not really so much around class as whether or not your parents went to university. So there are a whole set of mindset questions about who is thinking of preparing to go to university and who not. I've already mentioned variation by ethnicity, but about a decade ago, there was actually quite an interesting study done at my university that showed some of the participation rates by ethnicity and gender. And it was interesting what one found out about gender and participation even in an urban area like Toronto. And so certain ethnicities, Portuguese and Greek were two of them, had a very low participation rate of females. In Canada also, the rate of the participation rate in university depends a lot on the proximity of there being a university close to your home. It's not that you necessarily go to that university, that's the thing you might immediately think of, but it is around mindset, and the sort of presence of a university nearby has people thinking differently through high school. And whether you go to that university or you travel, you know, hundreds of kilometers to go to another, it still affects the participation rate. But then again, I've used the phrase before, if you scratch below those surfaces, you need to look again at the rates of completion of high school. And I would suggest that that is quite relevant, especially you gave some very interesting statistics on that for India, until you can push up that completion of public school and, of course, then high school, you can't push participation rate even higher. And you certainly can't in any quality way. Because even if you somehow push them out of high school without the skills, you're then going to have to do catch-up at university. And even if you then get them out of university, where's that going to get you in the labor market? So going back again to Canada, but I hope to raise it as a more general question about labor market needs, what we are increasingly finding is that industry will not do training. They expect people to come ready-made out of college or university straight into their first job on their first day and somehow be fully trained. You know, it's never been that way. It just never has been. But industry seems to now expect that the training is done earlier in the system. Another thing increasingly in Canada is that industry is not doing R&D as much either. Canada has some fairly decent statistics on R&D, which I would have brought if my topic hadn't changed while I was on the ground changing planes in Toronto. But they expect government to somehow provide these things. And in fact, the R&D in Canada is largely done in the universities, not by industry, and increasingly not by government research labs either. So the expectations are somehow that university and college, where applicable, does the training, does the R&D, somehow does everything that then prepares for later. So in terms of now some comments on quality, and again, I want to raise more general issues that I hope will be more broadly applicable as questions. I just point out, as a former mathematician, that only 200 universities can, in fact, be in the top 200. And the same applies. Only 500 universities can, in fact, be in the top 500. And this, you know, continual push for, you know, we want to be in the top 200, we want to be in the top 500, you know, we want to go up X number of places in the rankings, is not probably the best way to be addressing things if you're looking for a more general policy that will in fact help the labor market, very often the very local labor market, not even the national labor market. The labor market doesn't necessarily need a country to have, you know, 10 universities in the top 200. It doesn't necessarily make a lot of difference. What is important is quality. And quality can go up without your ranking going up. There, you know, that seems like an obvious fact, but people talk all the time about rankings as if they are the indicator of quality. So the quality of an institution, and there are many ways to try to increase that, to try to ascertain that through peer review, external peer review, and so on, and Canada, again, has a very well-developed system for that, can really be important in increasing quality of education. So a couple other points, and some hark back to some of what Rupa said. One tends to talk employment and talk about employment and unemployment, but what's really important to also talk about is underemployment. And especially if you look at some of those GERs and the labor market statistics that we've just seen, and so we've seen them for India, but you know, you could probably do the same thing for Canada or any number of other places. It's around some of that underemployment that's important. And if we're giving people bachelor's degrees, and in many cases master's degrees, to do what 20 years ago could be done by somebody with a high school education, we're not really doing anybody a favor. We are keeping people out of the labor market for longer. We are leading to frustrations on the part of those individuals. They have spent more years in school, and they will say, access for what? But also they will have spent more money if they've been forced to go to a private institution for some reason. But also, other than generating business opportunities for private institutions, where does that actually lead society in any sense? I could say the same looking at public institutions. We can educate people for longer and longer in bachelor's programs and master's programs, but if they go back to a job, which they could have done with a good high school education, we've wasted a lot of public money that probably could have been spent on something else. And so, in a way, I would like, not just at this conference, but just in general in the literature, for people to go back and look a little bit more at some of those fundamental questions, which I think are applicable across the world, regardless of whether it's BRICS or you know, countries that are considered highly developed or that have very high GER already, such as Canada. We still have all those same fundamental questions, and I think those are some of the ones that that we should be asking. Thank you.
Thank you very much to all the speakers. session here with some important problems being raised, which are common to many countries. I actually could see immediately how some of these problems have equivalent problems in Brazil regarding the expansion of the private sector, regarding the evaluation, the quality, the assessment of the work which is being done by the higher education system. I think we have lots of material here for discussions, and I'm quite sure that there will be questions now. And I also am sure that in the next sessions, some of these problems will come back because they are very relevant problems. Thank you very much. So we are open to questions now, comments to the audience. I suggest that we first listen to the audience, and then you can reply, and so start with them. Yes, please.
Isaac Frumian, High School of Economics, Moscow. Thanks a lot. I have a question on engineering, private education, because from what I read in our book, India is a unique case where private, where engineering education grew through the private provision. And it looks really strange now when you mentioned that only 15 or 20% of the graduates of the engineering departments get an employment. Because usually we assume that the private education works in the sectors where the payoff is obvious. So how would you look at this contradiction, and why India is this unique case when, again, private providers do engineering education, unlike other countries where they concentrate in business, management, etc.
Inês Penha Cisne, Graduate School of Economics, Getúlio Vargas Foundation in Rio de Janeiro. I would like first to congratulate the panelists for very interesting presentations. And just to add one point that I don't know it has been a matter of discussion or in the book, which is the fact that India has time on its side, meaning that the dependency ratio, I mean, those who are children or the elderly people as compared to working age population, this is going to achieve a minimum in India in 2040 or something like That's this, good. Whereas it has already reached the peak in Russia in 2010, in China right now, 2015, and in Brazil, 2020. So time is on your side. I'd like to know, it's a very good idea. It's very fortunate that you can still have 25 years to plan how to have all these people in the higher education system. Thank you.
I'll start with a comment that 80% of the students who go abroad in the United States, they come from such universities which are not best universities of India. I'm starting with a statement again that 80% of the students from India who go to United States do not represent the best universities of India. Now, coming to the question, you know, that why private sector is participating more in engineering programs when you compare it with the rest of the countries where they participate more in business studies or management programs. Probably you can see that from 2000 to 2003, you know, engineering program was not very open to Indian students. A survey was carried out in 2002 and 3 by the Secretary of University Grants Commission. And the survey revealed that almost 90% of the students who go abroad for engineering programs at the undergraduate level are those who could not seek admission in good Indian institutions of engineering. Now, you can see that up to 2002, this was the scenario. After 2002, the government of India opened the engineering of professional programs. Prior to 2002, as you said, the engineering program started with a couple of states in southern states, you know, like Tamil Nadu, and somewhat in Maharashtra. Rest of the provinces did not have private engineering college until 2002. The proliferation of private engineering colleges started after the year 2002 in India in almost all the provinces. Now, majority of the students pursuing 12th standard in science in India and their parents had a mind stake to send their kids either for the engineering or medicine. Since medicine was expensive, so most of them went for engineering program. So you can see in 2004 and 5, the number of students, the share of engineering program or the enrollment in the engineering program of the higher education was just 6%, which reached to almost 16-17%, including the IT program. Fine. This is one. Unfortunately, majority of these engineering programs have not been up to date in terms of their curriculum. But despite that, many of the engineers who go for their postgraduate programs have been doing very good in the United States. There are case studies, as even Simon mentioned in his lecture. So this is one. The second is, I think he was talking about the demographic dividend that India could have in the forthcoming years, you know. Fortunately, we have started working on that. We have developed a skill development council at the national level, even at the state level. Government is looking at it very seriously. And the present government has also proposed a new education policy which would be released in a couple of months, both for higher education and for the school education. So we are very optimistic, you know, that despite low quality, despite the low GER, India has produced good engineers and they have done good at international level in terms of consultancy and many of the things, you know. So probably we are going to have, this is how we need to do, you know, the policy issues is an important, you know, how we frame the policy to in order to have the benefit of demographic dividend in the forthcoming years while compared to rest of the countries.
Yes, please.
Just like to add a little bit onto the second question, which is, when one talks about demographic dividend, that looks attractive, right? That so many more people in the right age groups, all premised on continual growth. There are things in the world that tell us that continual growth may not be the way forward, and questions around sustainability and so on do, of course, increasingly come up and need to be considered. And political scientists have written on this. It's not my point at all. But a demographic dividend can quickly become demographic nightmare if the labor market cannot keep up. And so I don't know that it's necessarily a positive there. You know, without further action to think about sustainability, it may become a negative. But also talking about the labor market, one thing that perhaps I forgot to mention is that some of the mindset also needs to change about walking out into a job and that the labor market creates the jobs. That maybe isn't working so well as it needs to. And this, I think, accounts for why in many countries you see an increased focus on entrepreneurship as in creating your own job, basically, but also on co-op and experiential education. It has many different names in different places, internships and so on, as ways to also introduce industry to the students who are coming along and, in a way, give that training, which I referred to as lacking, while still at university. So there are many paths forward around that. But my basic point here was just simply that demographic dividend isn't necessarily a dividend unless we take some positive, proactive steps to make it an actual dividend.
Point in terms of the issue raised about the contradiction of private education in engineering, in spite of the fact that, you know, the engineering graduates are not getting absorbed into the job market, there's still a very, very large demand for engineering education. As you can see, most parents would want their kids in India to either go for engineering or medicine. So I think the private education system is responding to this very high demand of families looking for engineering degrees and engineering programs because there are such restriction options within India. So there is a huge market there that the private education is responding to regardless of what happens to them post finishing that degree. So there is that demand. So as it might sound on the surface.
My name is Michael Cross from the University of Johannesburg in South Africa. It's a bit of a puzzle for me when I go to sessions like this. After listening to the experience of India, I wonder whether the choice they are making there and the developments and, that you mapped out through the trends that were shown in those diagrams and tables, whether those choices can be taken for granted. And what I have in mind here is I can see a trend also in China, as you are highlighting, that led like moving towards opening more space for private institutions to take place. And it could be that also within the institution themselves, there are other changes. What I'm concerned with is today we are moving towards a situation where training is for profit, programs are for profit, research are for profit. The labor market dictates what we do. Is there any space in India left for something like public good in all these things that we're doing or they're doing in India, because it looks like it's an overwhelming trend? Is there any space or can we actually take seriously this issue that critical scholars like Torres, for example, would call the neoliberal common sense? And I guess that's the reason why very often we discuss these issues and we take them for granted. Like there's a consensus in terms of these choices that they're doing the job and they're meeting the goals that we set for ourselves.
Good morning, thank you. My name is Marcos Carnaval from Brazilian Institute of Lawyers. And we saw in the presentation from Professor Joss some numbers from market share regarding course, university course in India. Could you talk something about the low market share of law course? Because here in Brazil, we know that most of the 80% of the offers from universities is law course. If you can talk something about this low market share of a law course, I thank you. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
The first question regarding public good. Let me start with, you know, a student getting master's degree in economics or sociology or political science in India still pays less than $50 for the 2-year program. So probably you can imagine that the level of subsidies that public institutions have been offering in India as of the date is still very low as compared to other countries, you know. Just with $50, you know, a student gets a master's degree in economics or political science from a university. For the, that is for 2 years program, 4 semesters program. Fine. So the public institutions are still highly subsidized. Some of the provinces also control the private institutions' tuition structure through a mechanism of a committee, you know. For example, in a province like Gujarat, you know, we have a committee that looks after the tuition structure of private institutions, especially engineering and medicine program, you know. So there are provinces in India where even the private institutions are controlled in terms of the funding mechanism or the funding that has to be done by the students for getting access. So we definitely do have the public good character, but in fact, the number of such institutions are declining at a very greater pace. That is the worry that we have, you know. If you talk about the elite institutions, 90% of them are in the public sector, whether it is Indian Institute of Technology, Indian Institute of Management, fine. All are in public sector. There are very few qualitative or providing good quality education in private sector. Unfortunately, this is a part, you know, despite having enhanced the access in higher education, the private sector has not been able to address the quality issue. Fine. So definitely the public good character is declining very fast. That is an issue that is worrisome for us. I couldn't get your question. I'm sorry, you know.
I am talking about the market share of the course in India. You show us that art, the have a high market share, engineering have a high market share, and law,
okay,
there is a reduced market share. Could you talk something about it? Because here in Brazil, most of 80%, maybe 80% of the course from universities is in law.
So law?
In right. Yeah.
Fine. The market share in arts discipline of law faculty in India is not very high. It's not very high. It's roughly 35-40%. Law is still with the public sector, you know. Most of the colleges that provide, we call it as LLB, you know, an LLM, that is bachelor's degree and master's degree in law. Master's degree is almost 90% with the university, that is public sector, and almost 30-35% is with the private universities and private colleges that provide your bachelor's degree in law.
Thank you. My name is Luis Passoni from Universidade Estadual do Norte Fluminense, Northern Rio de Janeiro State University. I'm curious about the role for distance education in India, and also if you face the problem of students' evasion before finishing the course. In India and elsewhere, you are aware about it. Thank you.
The share of distance education in Indian higher education is roughly 14%. Fine. So that has been almost stagnant during last 5-6 years. Fine. And as far as the dropout is concerned, you know, the dropout has declined drastically with the increase in the private institutions' participation in higher education. Probably you can link that with the tuition, you know. that could be a major reason that the dropout rate in higher education in India during last one decade has declined drastically, you know. So that's the one.
There is clear some points here which should be discussed in depth that regards the, as I mentioned before, the evaluation of the higher education system, the participation of the private sector, which I think has been very intense in these countries, and we should, I mean, this should come back for discussion. So let's thank our panelists for their very interesting exposition here. Thank you very much.